Hi everyone, welcome back to another episode in this series of Devlogs, documenting the development of a co-op heist game in Unity. In this episode, I'll cover the technique I'll be using to create the bank buildings the player can rob, and the surrounding neighbourhoods that will set the stage for the player's daring escape. I've also done a bit of work on improving the player's character model, and made a shader for showing damage on any 3D props. So let's get going. Voxels are usually used as a way of representing terrain. The most famous example, of course, being Minecraft. However, in Heist, I'll just be using them for the buildings, although at some point in the future, I could potentially use voxels for the ground as well, which could give players the opportunity to tunnel their way into a bank vault. I'm personally not a massive fan of the look of blocky voxel games, so I'm going to be using a hybrid system of voxels and conventional meshes to allow for fully destructive buildings, but without the jagged visuals of a purely voxel-based approach. The first step in building a voxel system is to decide on a data structure for the voxels. I'll be using a single byte to represent the voxel's material type, and a boolean to store whether the voxel is alive, or whether it has been destroyed by a player or an AI agent. Because I'm storing the voxel type as a byte, we have the space for 256 types of voxel, but as we'll use 0 to represent an empty voxel, this leaves us with space for 255 different types of voxel material. I'll break the voxel types into groups: rough concrete, polished concrete, metal plating, metal tubing, and then a section for special materials that don't fit in with any of the others. Using the voxel data structure we've just defined, I can build a three-dimensional array to store a voxel struct instance for every possible voxel within a certain space. Because we need to generate and potentially demolish the building meshes at runtime, it will be very inefficient to make an entire building just one mesh. This is because if a player destroys a tiny section of a building, the entire mesh would need to be regenerated to show that damage. So I'll break the buildings into smaller chunks. At the moment, I've decided each voxel will be 1/3 of a meter, or 33 centimeters long, and each chunk will be 3 meters in size, and contains 3,375 voxels. In order to create the voxel buildings, I'll need some sort of editor, so I made a new scene and started putting the UI together. To get something up and running, I implement a simple but very inefficient renderer that places a cube at every populated voxel. Once the building editor is working, the next step is to iterate on this voxel renderer and make it more efficient by only putting faces where they will be visible, and to introduce some smooth beveled edges to make the buildings look a little nicer. For my first attempt at this, I decided to produce a nice smooth mesh for every possible voxel shape. By breaking the voxels in half, we reduce the amount of unique tiles needed. We can visualize this a lot easier on 2D tiles, but the theory remains the same in 3D. However, I soon realized that meant there were still 128 possible combinations of voxels. Granted, the majority of these are rotations or flipped versions of a few basic shapes. Now, around this point, you may be shouting at the screen,
"Have you gorgeous chiseled Adonis of a man? Why are you adding beveled corners to the buildings? Buildings have sharp corners, not round ones."
And you'd be totally correct in asking that. It was around the second day of me being lost in the voxel source. I was distracting myself browsing the Google Street View of Akihabara in Tokyo, and I realized these buildings, and for that matter nearly all buildings, don't have any beveled edges, like at all. Even the buildings that have some unique curved sides still mostly have 90 degree sharp corners. I guess at some point I got so obsessed with attempting to hide the voxels, either that or I was trying to become the next Akira Toriyama or Fred Flintstone, I guess I just lost sight of the fact that buildings are in fact not round. Some might say my brain gained a wrinkle that day. It was time for a new approach. Now, I still want to smooth out some of the sharp corners to reduce the blocky, voxely look, so I settled on three slightly beveled meshes that could be used only for vertical, convex corners. This way, the inside, or concave corners, will still be sharp and simple, but it'll give the building structures a bit of their own style and pizzazz. By mixing these three smooth meshes, and by placing a flat quad mesh at every intersection between a populated voxel and an empty one, we can start generating better building meshes. One problem with this approach at the moment is that it produces high poly meshes for shapes that could be very simply reproduced with a far lower poly count. A quick partial fix for this is to work in vertical strips, and if two or more voxels would use the same mesh, we simply stretch one mesh over those several voxels. This is far from perfect, but it's a start. Another benefit of this approach is that we can use the same data for the physics colliders, which offer us a tiny bit of optimization. But I think I will have to reapproach this in the future to further reduce the amount of box colliders. Now that we've got the voxels working, we can make some rather basic and ugly looking buildings. The next step is to start decorating these buildings with props and decals. So I added some prop and decal sections to the UI and populated them with some scriptable object data containers that list all possible props and decals and their respective menu sprites. When the user places a prop or decal, it appears in the hierarchy, allowing it to be moved, rotated, or deleted. I'd like to add a transform gizmo here, but I couldn't find any that work with the new Unity input system. So at some point, I'll probably just have to code one myself. But for the time being, I'm just going to use some text inputs for the small tweaks. At the moment, I'm running all the mesh creation code on the main thread, which works for now, but in the future, I will absolutely need to shift this code to a separate thread or a compute shader to stop it interrupting the game and causing stutters or low frame rates. Because the props in the game will need to be damaged during the gunfights, I needed to come up with a solution that shows them getting damaged, but without requiring me to model separate damaged versions of every prop. The shader I've made for showing damage fades in a dark grunge map over the diffuse texture and offsets the vertices of the prop in a random direction. It's a bit of a hacky effect, but I think it should be quite effective during gameplay. After playing as the prototype character model for a short time, two problems quickly became evident. They are that the head was too big, and more so, these giant sausage fingers were not going to be able to interact with any fiddly gun models. So to fix the hands, I started by taking some reference photos of my own hands and started box meshing something similar. I then finished this off by sculpting some small details over the top, such as tendons, knuckles, and little stubby bits of flesh to represent where the fingernails would start. On the whole, I am mostly happy with the prototype character, so I simply reduced the head size, slapped a better nose on, and then welded the new hands to the existing mesh. Once I had a new player mesh, I decided to finally have a go at making some clothes. I picked up a subscription for Marvelous Designer, which is a piece of software I'm really looking forward to learning. I just start off with some basic patterns and simulate them to the mesh. I'm out of time for this episode, but hopefully I can start retopologizing and UV mapping these clothes in the next episode. And that's it for now. I'm going to stop trying to predict what's going to be in future episodes for a while, as my day job has really gotten in the way of late, but I'm still going to be trying my best to stick to the same schedule. So tune back in 3 weeks' time for the next update. Bye for now.